PPI, we talk of acid, whether it is a friend or foe. I guess whatever we are born with is definitely some good purpose. So if you talk of acid, it has a role in digestion and it has a lot of anti-infective properties. At the same time, a minority, they suffer due to hyperacidity. So we know that acid is important for protein digestion, absorption of calcium, iron and vitamin B12. And bacterial overgrowth is noted in those who don't have good amount of acid production. We know about achlorhydria. And at the other extreme, where there is an increase acid production, like in Zolliger Allison, we get a lot of ulcers. It also has, perhaps, reduces the allergenicity of food. So acid secretion, we know there are multiple the stimulus to produce that, the gastrin produced by the G cells, the histamine, the muscarinic receptors, and the final pathway of acid secretion is the proton pump. So peptic ulcer disease, if you look at conventional, for centuries ago, the conventional treatment for acid peptic disease was vagotomy and pyloroplasty, till there was a little breakthrough in the form of discovery of H2 receptor blocker. And then after a decade, we realized that in fact the culprit is not the acid but the H. pylori, and then the role of surgery in the acid peptic disease became very less. And now we have the PPI, which have largely taken away the role of surgeons in dealing with the acid peptic disorders. So PPI are a group of drug causing most potent inhibition of gastric acid secretion and one of the most widely used sold drug, so much so that omeprazole found a place in WHO model list of essential medicine. And the fact that, I mean, many of us in the auditorium may be surviving without an acid, because many of us take, you know, PPI, we really wonder whether acid is really needed in today's day. Trend of PPI has increased several fold despite, and this is the data from the countries which produce guidelines that this should not be used in younger population, and there are multiple reasons for this. PPI metabolism enzymes matures at the age of 6 to 12 months, and hence usage below 1 year certainly is expected to have more side effect. But now we have a guideline where, you know, PPI even recommended in 2011 up to the age of 1 month. So if you look at the guidelines, this is the latest guideline in this year. In infant with suspicion of GERD, if there are no alarm signs, basically you have to do non-pharmacological method. And if they don't improve, 2 to 4 weeks of dairy-free diet. If they don't improve, referral to pediatric gastro. Till this stage, the guideline doesn't speak of usage of PPI, but how many of really wait for this? And where this is not possible, 4 to 8 weeks of medication trial. In fact, the previous guideline on GERD in infant had no role of usage of acid suppressant without a diagnosis. This has at least given some way where you are not able to reach to a pediatric GI, that you give a trial of 4 to 8 weeks. And if you look at in an older child, definitely the usage of PPI is at a little, you know, earlier in the algorithm, where there is no improvement on lifestyle and dietary modification, that one can try. But definitely it should be continued for 4 to 8 weeks and then stop. So what are the right uses and what are the misuses or the, you know, inappropriate uses of PPI? GERD, certainly PPI has a role, especially if it is an erosive esophagitis. But where are we using? We are using for GER. H. pylori eradication, certainly PPI is one of the triple component therapy in all the regimen. But what we do is, we start H. pylori treatment, we are expected to finish at 2 months, but the child gets better, there is no follow-up, he continues to take it, and the PPI babies grow as the PPI children and PPI adults. They feel that PPI is something which they can take whenever they want. Ulcer prevention in ICU, there is a role of usage of PPI, but we have seen many children who get hospitalized in this first treatment, blanket treatment, IV fluid, an antibiotic, and an acid suppressant, irrespective whether he is admitted for any reason related to that. Stress gastritis, there is a definite role, but what we are using is for all abdominal pain, because this is something which we find very safe, And if you look at functional abdominal pain, the guidelines don't give us any, you know, I mean, clue as to what we can use. The guidelines are blank. The counseling doesn't help. The child wants, the parent wants some prescription. And the first thing which comes from our pen is a PPI. Eosinophilic esophagitis, yes, but how much of UC? Very uncommon in this part of the world. We are blessed with that. And where are we using? For colic. Any child who is crying, again, you don't have much to give, so that comes. And asthma, look at the pulmonologist. They are using it left and right for asthma, which is not responding to conventional treatment. And this widespread misuse is not a local phenomena, it is a global phenomena. And the reasons are non-prescription availability, ease of administration, formulation appropriate for infant, young children, and infrequent side effect, and the lack of evidence for pharmacotherapy in other areas. Mostly it is empiric use rather than on a diagnostic testing, and it is basically 10% of them only have a formal diagnosis that, okay, this PPI is needed. Rest all, they receive it on empiric basis. And the results are commonly available tests which are meant for diagnosis of GERD. They really don't correlate well with symptoms. And erosive esophagitis, which does respond well to PPI, is distinctly uncommon in infant, which, where such that routine endoscopy may not be justified in such symptoms. Side effects, generally well tolerated. The most common adverse effects seen in the pediatric patients are headache, diarrhea, constipation, and nausea. An elevated rate of viral and bacterial infection of the GI tract, especially the C. difficile type, as well as increased bacterial pneumonia. So it is GI infection and the respiratory infection which are more common. So a very good paper by Onston, where the PPI was used along with as an alternate to placebo, and the study showed that in the crying babies, PPI don't do any better than placebo. Rather, there is increased risk of respiratory tract infection. So the PPI, they affect the defense mechanism, the digestion, the calcium, idiosyncratic reactions. They may increase the risk of allergy and, of course, a lot of interaction. What is? So we in gastroenterology have 10-minute session for PPI in a 3-day conference. So certainly, ENT, surgeon, they cannot afford any time for PPI, and they are the ones who are using left and right. So it's very difficult to keep them updated. So what can be done to curtail the epidemic of inappropriate PPI prescription? Increase primary care and subspecialist physician awareness of the response of uncomplicated infant reflux to non-pharmacological treatments. You have to tell them guidelines that first is non-pharmacological. Education of parents as part of anticipatory guidance to reset expectations. So pain abdomen, you have to tell them there's nothing that guides me to give some medication and it will take some time.